When we think of the regional evolution of Homo erectus, the last region to actually be occupied is Europe. So if we begin to look at a map, we have Homo erectus remains at Dmanisi at 1.8 million years of age. At Southeast Asia, we have it perhaps only slightly later in time than that, maybe by 1.6 million years of age. In East Asia, at some sites in China, possibly as early as 1.6, 1.7 million years of age. There's now good archaeological evidence from the Niuan Basin in northern China that goes back to about 1.8 million years of age, or almost the same time as Dmanisi. Europe's a little different. For whatever reasons, and those reasons might be geographic, they might have to do with the climate of Europe at the time, or maybe simply the fact that Europe is simply a smaller landmass compared to these other areas, Europe wasn't occupied till after 1.5 million years of age. The earliest evidence goes back to about maybe 1.4, although maybe more reliably 1.2 million years of age. And the early sites that we have in Europe are all from southern Europe. Spain, south of the Pyrenees, southern Italy, and even southern Greece are the earliest evidence we have of occupation in Europe. One of the earliest specimens we have is actually this specimen from Italy, from the site of Ciprano. Now, this is a specimen that was actually found by accident in the midst of road construction. Road construction revealed this specimen, and it's a massive skull. Because of the nature of its discovery, we don't have an exact date on it, but it might be 800,000 years of age. And it's a very large, large-brained, robust specimen. Looking at it, we can see that it has both a long vault, but also a very tall specimen. So the cranial vault height is very significant as well. It also has very thick bones. One of the things we'll see throughout the erectus lineage is that at least for the first half of it, we see increasing cranial vault thickness. The bones themselves are getting thicker as the cranial vaults are expanding. This specimen has a very massive supraorbital torus, a little bit of a supraorbital sulcus, this gap right here, a fairly rounded frontal bone, a slightly projecting nuchal torus in the back, but overall it's a huge specimen. Again, if we look at it in the posterior view, you can see this shelf of bone that represents its nuchal torus, that posterior projection of the occipital bone in the back. You can see that it's a very wide cranial vault, especially posteriorly, at least how it's currently been reconstructed. And again in this image, you can see how thick these cranial bones are. Very thick cranial bones. Again, a trend that we see throughout erectus and is associated with the overall buttressing of the skull. The skull throughout the first half of the lineage of erectus gets bigger and thicker and more robust. Maybe contrary to what you might expect given the increasing gracility of the chewing apparatus, the jaws and teeth, but the overall cranium itself is getting larger and more robust. As brain size increases, so does the supraorbital torus, so does the overall structural anatomy of the skull itself. Perhaps the most famous early fossil site in Europe actually comes from northern Spain though, a site called Atapuerca. And Atapuerca, as it turns out, isn't one site, it's many sites. Atapuerca was a hillside that about 100 years ago, a passageway was cut through the center of it for the passage of a train. And it turns out that that passageway that was cut through the center of this hill revealed a number of fossil sites, spanning a range of Pleistocene ages. Some of the earliest are sites like Grandolina, Galleria, and Elefante. But there's also later middle Pleistocene sites, most notably Cima de los Huesos, deep, narrow cave shaft that actually is filled with the densest concentration of hominid fossils anywhere found in the fossil record. Hundreds of fossil hominid remains dating to sometime between 200 and 400,000 years of age, coupled with a bunch of cave bears. It's basically a pit full of hominid fossils and cave bear fossils, and is one of the most remarkable sites that we have of anywhere in the Pleistocene record. But when you look at these early remains from Atapuerca, some of the earlier ones from Grandolina, again going back to maybe 1 million to 1.2 million years of age, we have partial skeletal remains, which again allow for nice comparisons with other early skeleton material that we have from Dmanisi near Akademe. And we have a partial cranial specimen, TD6, shown here, which includes a well-preserved maxilla and also part of the frontal and parietals here. So we can see a narrowing supraorbital torus, one that's fairly thick centrally but actually narrows as it goes laterally. This is a characteristic that we'll see across the European sample as it turns out. We have a well-developed canine fossa, or this depression in the zygomatics in the cheeks just adjacent to the canine and canine root itself seen right here. But the real treasure trove of material from Atapuerca comes from later evidence. Evidence again from the Cima de los Huesos site, where we have hundreds and hundreds of specimens, including this very well-preserved skull, Atapuerca 5, seen right here in the center of this image. But we also have a fantastically preserved pelvis and a multitude of other postcranial and especially dental remains. Hundreds of teeth from Atapuerca, providing a wealth of data for not just reconstructing the biology of these specimens, the morphology and what they looked like, but also the life history. looking at patterns of mortality, for example. Atapuerca gives us one of the best glimpses into what patterns of mortality may have looked like in the Pleistocene. And again, recall that mortality is a really important element of thinking about human demography. Human demography being something that evolution can act upon, can shape and structure. So looking at Atapuerca though, looking at these specimens, here are two of the better preserved specimens from Cima de los Huesos. Atapuerca 5 on the right, Atapuerca 4 on the left. And again, we have fairly round globular skulls with a high cranial vault in addition to a fairly long overall cranial vault. Notice that posteriorly, we get a little bit of projection of the occiput, particularly in this upper half of the occipital bone here with a slight flexure going down into the lower half of that bone. This posteriorly projecting occiput we'll see is something that's characteristic of the European lineage, something that we see later in time actually with later European specimens such as the Neanderthals. We have a fairly well-developed supraorbital torus that projects slightly with only a moderate supraorbital sulcus, if any, at present. One of the things that we see though throughout all the European specimens is the distinctive facial structures. Unlike those flat anteriorly facing zygomatics that we saw in some of the Asian specimens, such as those from Xokochen, we have more laterally oriented or obliquely oriented cheeks. Almost as if you grab the nose of this specimen and pulled the face forward. So you have basically a continuous projection going across the midface from the lateral aspects of the zygomatics going forward to the nasal aperture. It gives this expanded puffy appearance of the midface of these specimens. So there's an expanded midfacial region in these specimens. One interpretation of this is that it's been thought to be correlated with the colder climate found in Europe in the Ice Age, Inter-Ice Age periods that we see throughout the Pleistocene. That large midface may have to do with actually the size of the nasal cavity and the changes in the air that is inhaled through the nasal cavity, and having a larger space allows you to add humidity to that air more readily and also deal with the temperature difference of having to breathe cold air. So that's one hypothesis, that this large midface in these European specimens has to do with climatic adaptation to the cold conditions found in Pleistocene Europe. Looking posteriorly at these specimens, we can again see this sort of shelf of bone that we associate with the nuchal torus on both of these specimens, much as we saw with the earlier remains from Ciprano. Notice that this nuchal torus that we see on these European specimens is not quite the same nuchal torus that we saw on those specimens from Southeast Asia. If we recall those specimens from San Juan and the island of Java, they had a nuchal torus that literally projected out of the back of the skull. It was like a shelf of bone across the back. This one forms a distinctive gap here. You can see this actual bar of bone that runs across, but it doesn't project so much posteriorly off the back of the skull. Also on these specimens, you'll see a little bit of depression immediately above the nuchal torus, seen as a slight shadow on these pictures that we refer to as a supraeniac fossa. This is again a European feature, something we see predominantly in these Pleistocene European specimens. Here's a specimen actually from Greece, from the site of Petrolona. This is a site that again we don't have very good context given the discovery of this specimen, but we think is middle Pleistocene in age, something in the 200 to 400, maybe slightly older time period. And again, what we see is many of the same features we saw at Atapuerca. We have a very thick supraorbital torus that thins as you go laterally. It takes the form of double arches, in this case, disconnected in the middle. There's a little bit of gap in the supraorbital torus. We again have a rounded frontal bone that extends into a broad globular overall shape of the cranial vault. Again, we have a midface that projects from the lateral zygomatic coming forward all the way to the nasal aperture. And notice the very large nasal aperture that this specimen has, with large nasal bones heading down into it. But the projecting midface gives these European specimens a distinct maxillary and frontal morphology, where the whole front of the face is brought forward associated with this large nasal aperture, large orbits, and cheeks that extend obliquely all across the side of the face. So these are some of the features that we see characteristic of these European specimens. And again, Europe was the last occupied region of the Old World, perhaps because of climatic or geographic barriers, but it was the last occupied and it was probably also the least populated. Europe is small relative to the other land masses and also probably had a slightly more difficult climatic environment given the extent of glaciation across much of Europe throughout the Pleistocene. But there are still distinctive features that we see in these specimens. That prognathic midface, the development of a slightly projecting occipital torus on the back of the skull, and some of the round globular features of the cranial elements are elements that we see throughout the European Pleistocene fossil record.